As I was putting together this next lesson, part of it even seems like it's being ripped from the headlines today. And I had a hard time kind of weeding through, staying on target, because there's probably about five or six wild rabbits that fold right into what's going on in the headlines that I can make this into a five-part series just on the story of Cain and Abel. But I want to get into this. I kind of feel like by the end of the year we're going to be doing Understanding the Kingdom Part 52. Because there is so much. But how many know if there was ever a day and age to really understand the kingdom of God? It's right now. We have got to know that this is God's kingdom and that this over here is the devil's kingdom. We've got to separate clean from unclean, holy from profane, and begin walking in the holy like never before. Now, we have discovered that the Nehesh offered Adam and Eve knowledge which he claimed would lead to godhood. And this last week or so, I have run across in Doug Woodward and many other books that I've been reading just how many New Agers and even those from the UN are seeking. They literally say, we are still to this day seeking the knowledge of good and evil that we may become gods. So what I'm saying is not just some ancient thing, that even those that deny the God of this Bible still use it to define what they're seeking after. That makes you kind of wonder that if they can validate that part of the Bible, maybe the rest of it's true too and they're deceived. But we have discovered that instead of godhood, what Adam and Eve were infected with was this new nature that had been birthed in the heart of Satan. It's called iniquity. And when we eventually work our way to the New Testament toward end time things, we're going to find out there's a mystery working with that iniquity, that it has been working for about 6,000 years to birth a specific character named the Antichrist. But Adam and Eve were birthed with this nature on the inside of them, and this new nature separated from them from God. It caused them to be cast out of the garden lest they take of the tree of life and be forever locked, just like the devil was, forever locked in a sinful state. Now in the lives of their sons, we discover how some basics of how this knowledge of good and evil begins manifesting in the first family. And I think we need to use the principle of first mention here, because when we understand the dynamic with Cain and Abel, we're going to understand what's going to happen in the last days. We're going to understand even history and church history. What's happened in America? Not just lately. How many know what's happening right now in America is not a new phenomenon? It has been working for almost probably since the early 1800s. It's been working, and even before that. In essence, when you really look at that, you had both Freemasons and Christians involved in the foundation and formation, it was manifested there as well. And so let's get into this in Genesis chapter 4, verses 1 and 2. And Adam knew Eve, his wife, and she conceived and bare Cain, and said, I have begotten a man from the Lord. And she bare him his brother Abel. And Abel was a keeper of sheep, but Cain was a tiller of the ground. Now, Adam and Eve had two sons. Now, what's interesting, and you know, looking at this, we can just take this right here, and we can kind of take a look at it. You know, God told Adam and Eve to take dominion and to flourish in the earth. And what we see here in both of these men is both of them manifested different giftings. Those giftings allowed them to flourish in this creation. Now, this is important, because what is going on today is Satan is either trying to usurp giftings or pacify them and nullify them, because if you can't find your gifting, you have no place, and if you have no place, you have no fulfillment. Abel was a keeper of the sheep. He was happy with it. There was no griping about it. Cain could have tended sheep just like his brother Abel, but instead his gifting was in tilling the ground. He was a farmer. One was a herder, one was a farmer. And both of them had joy and fulfillment in those things. And it enabled them to take dominion in those areas and to flourish. Now, each one of us You know, everybody's looking for their purpose. Your purpose will always be wrapped up in your gifting. Now the overall purpose for all of us is to bring glory to God. But the secondary purpose that brings real meaning in life, you know, it's kind of like what they always talk about on with work, that discover what you really love to do and you can do it the rest of your life and never work a day, because you can put 60 hours a week in it and you never consider it work because you love doing it. Now, I have to admit that sometimes you can be doing that and it's other people around you that end up being like the snake in the garden that all of a sudden make your play work, because they've not really discovered their giftings and their purpose in God. But every one of us, if we begin to really discover who we are in Christ and our placing and our giftings there, and to really begin concentrating on those, we will have fulfillment. But at the same time, it's those very things that causes us to bring glory to God. And this comes back to the basic Hebraic concept that work is godly. Come on. If Paul said, if everything I do is unto the Lord. So when I'm working and I'm expressing that gift, as I do it unto the Lord, that can transform the workplace. That can do a lot of things in our life. But yet at the same time, the kingdom of darkness either wants to infect your gifting, to pervert it for itself. I've seen a lot of people that don't know God that are in the music industry that have an anointing on their music. The devil did not give them that anointing. It came from the throne of God to be used by God. But the devil came into the earth and he took that which belonged to God and perverted it and used it for his own purposes. The biggest lie is the devil gave you something. The devil can't give you anything except iniquity and perversion. The true giftings that are on the inside of us all come from God, and he has one of two choices. He either can pervert that or seek to suppress it. And that's his only options. And so here with Cain and Abel, we have a story that as we begin to unfold this, both of them were thriving in what they were doing, yet with one, he began to pervert what they wanted to do. And guys, Why is this so important? Because I see right now in America, in the black community, in the white community, and it didn't really matter the race. And I don't even like using the word race, because what's going to happen here, I think, is as things unfold, we're going to realize no matter what color your skin, we are the human race, and there's another race getting ready to be injected in on the scene. And we're going to find out what a game the devil's been playing with us. Yes, we have an ethnic background. I'm a hodgepodge of a lot of different white cultures. But what I found is my whiteness can be redeemed by the grace of God, and I can just be who I am in Christ. And it goes that same way with any ethnic background. I mean, I got ministries that I love that are black congregations, and I go into their pulpits, and the first thing I say is, please excuse me, I enter into this thing handicapped. Because I'm not black. I can't preach it the way you can. And there is such a wonderful gift of doing that. Just let me teach. Because if I try to do what you do, I will hurt myself. Even though there are times I would like to. And believe me, I have. And not only have I hurt myself, I've probably hurt others in the congregation. But see, this ethnicity, they're dividing us up. But I see this growing anger. And what the anger really is because I can't discover my gifting. There are people, I believe, in the black community and in other poor communities that have giftings to be educators, to have giftings to be great inventors. But because the education and the circumstances were not presented to them, are suppressed by the enemy to cause this wellspring of anger. And he always likes to point at other people. It's the same thing over and over and over again. But only in God can I find my gifting and it flourish properly. But we get to this time all of a sudden, now both guys are using their giftings, and that wasn't the problem. The problem was in the offering. And we need to take note of this. The problem was in the offering, because God is extremely particular that you offer him that which fits his model, that which fits his kingdom, that which fits his ways, and no other ways. And so we find here, picking up in verse 3, and in the process of time it came to pass that Cain brought forth the fruit of the offering of the ground, an offering unto the Lord, and Abel he also brought of the firstlings of his flock and the fat thereof. And the Lord had respect unto Abel and his offering, but to Cain and to his offering he had not respect, and Cain was very wroth, and his countenance fell. Now, these are now grown men. And I don't believe it was like the age of accountability, like 13. I believe this was more like they were around 30, because there's also a concept you enter into your own priesthood at around 30. That's why Jesus had to wait till he was 30 even to begin his ministry. If you were born a Levite, you could not do your ministry, whether you're a Levite or a Cohen, until after your 30th birthday. You had to turn 30. There's something about that to mature, that God is requiring you to stand on your own. Now, we need to note before this, so these guys are probably, in my estimation, about 30 years old. So they have been raised their whole life. It goes all the way back to right before they got out of the garden. God killed several animals and made clothes for them. In fact, I've already quoted from Jameson Fawcett Brown, where they said that God made coats of skin, taught them to make these for themselves, thus implied the institution of animal sacrifice, which was undoubtedly of divine appointment, the instruction in the only acceptable mode of worship for sinful creatures through faith in a Redeemer. So God would say, listen, there's just one coming that I promised. Now, he's going to take care of this, but until he takes care of this, your sin has to be covered by blood. That's the only way. And so both these guys grow up that whether it was once a year or whenever Adam and Eve did it, they would see an animal sacrifice that was unto the Lord, and they knew that Adam and Eve trained them. We're going to see here in a little bit, because God told Cain, he said, don't you know what to do right? It's like, you've been doing this your whole life. It's like, this is the first family you grew up doing this. And how many of us have seen some of the greatest adversaries to the body of Christ grew up in church? Some of them used to be in ministry. Are now the very ones that are seeking to destroy the very thing that they were birthed out of. And so their whole life, he had been trained that this is how you're acceptable God. Now he gets to the place where he's old enough to offer an offering to himself. And what does he decide to do? I'm going to do it my way. All of a sudden, the knowledge of evil began to infect him. And he said, listen, I'm going to serve God my way. I don't care what God requires. Maybe he was the first hyper grace preacher for all I know. Because of grace, we can do whatever we want to do now. Because God didn't kill us in the garden, so he extended grace. We're all now under grace. I don't know. But he got in his head. Maybe it was because of pride. Why did Lucifer fall? Pride. I'm not going to trade my brother vegetables for a lamb. I'm going to serve God the way I want to serve him. I want to only accept his instruction that I like. I only want to sing the songs during the service that I like. And I tell you what, there will be hell to pay if the preacher deviates from what I like. Welcome, Brother Cain. It's all about him. And he rejected and that's about their only instruction, guys. Was this is the way that you worship me. Now, what's really interesting here, it says that God had respect for Abel's offering. Now, look at the word here in Hebrew, sha'ah, in Hebrew. And what's really cool about this word, as I begin taking the Hebrew part, it means to look upon, to regard, to gaze at, to look at intently. At the same time, it means to look away and cause one's gaze to turn. And I looked at that and I'm thinking, Lord, What does this mean? And literally, what I got as I was putting this together, The blood of the sacrifice allowed God to look away from sin and at the same time to look at the one who was standing in obedience. I mean, if I hadn't been sitting down this morning putting this together, I'd have had to get myself up out of the floor. That the blood enabled him to look away from the sin, but to see the one who was covered by the blood acting in obedience. That's the story of Christ. That's the story of what he did for us. If I'm in Christ, God can overlook the sin because it's covered in the blood, and he can look at me and say, because of your obedience, I've accepted me and now learning to walk in my ways. My face can shine upon you. See, that's part of the Aaronic blessing. May God look upon you. May his face shine upon you. Man, that's the only place of blessings. Oh, you're not getting it. The blood allows God to look at me, and when God gazes upon me, all the blessings of the kingdom are extended to me because of the blood. Now, if that isn't enough to get happy about, I don't know what is. But we can even take it a step further. Everything that I'm dealing with, this is a historical fact, but there are types and shadows in the story. Now, Jameson Foster Brown, when talking about this respect, they say this: the words had respect to signify in Hebrew to look at anything with a keen, earnest glance, which has been translated kindled into a fire, so that the divine approval of Abel's offering was shown as being consumed by fire. That's how Abel knew God accepted his sacrifice. He set it all there, and God set the fire. Cain set all his stuff up, no fire. What's that a type and shadow of? Two things. Number one, I remember there was a prophet who made an altar on Mount Carmel. His name was Elijah. And he built this altar. Why could he have confidence of building that altar and knowing that God would send fire to approve it? It had already happened once before. He knew from the Torah that God had accepted Abel's sacrifice by fire, but he also known that the Cain-type sacrifice, that of the prophets of Baal, would not be accepted by fire. He went in there with confidence, knowing what was going to be the outcome. Now, level two. When I come under the blood, because I accept the sacrifice. You see, if I deal with the cross, I will be led to Pentecost. That the sacrifice that I now have received and the blood of Jesus is covering my spirit and covering my heart, that God's fire of acceptance and approval will fall on that sacrifice, and all of a sudden the Holy Spirit of God and the fire of God begins to fall within. We call it the baptism in the Holy Spirit. It's all right here in this story if you dig just a little deep. Now, do you know why I said this morning already that I could have done three sessions just out of this? It's so powerful. God had respect for one, and he did another. Now, Cain chose another way. The knowledge of good and evil coursed through his spirit and his soul and caused him to reject the instruction of God. Cain rejected God's instruction to develop his own way of serving God, and he demanded that it be accepted. Can you pull that from the headlines today? God has a standard. You know, I read this week before the Supreme Court that if they vote in favor of gay marriage, that 50% of the churches in America will close as a result. Not only that, even one of the justices asked this: if we open the door to this, because this is something that we've never seen before, what other kinds of doors is that going to open? Well, this morning I read an article from Great Britain that has approved gay marriage now for quite a while, that they're now taking another step: three-way marriage. polygamy. While they're sitting in the Supreme Court saying, we would never do that, they're already doing it in Great Britain. Once you reject God's instruction, then anything the kingdom of darkness wants will prevail, because you have left the borders, you have jumped the fence, you're now out in uncharted territory. You see, there are places that don't live by this book that men marry girls as young as 5 and 6. In America, we would call that pedophilia. But it's legal in those countries. Why? This book hasn't been preached. You see, the whole dichotomy right now in America is that at its founding, we had Cains and we had Abels. And the Cains worked secretly within the Masonic lodges, within esoteric societies, while they, in occult fashion, allowed Abel to thrive on the outside, and it brought God's blessing. But now they're getting to the place that it is obvious. You cannot say to a nation, may God bless America, when America is doing what it's doing. We're entering into a time, guys, I believe we're going to have spot judgment and spot blessing. And the more that happens, the worse it's going to get with Cain, and the more he's going to hate Abel. You see, the real truth is, I think the whole thing behind those that are promoting the redefinition of marriage has nothing to do with gay, lesbians, transgender, or transsexuals. They're simply a tool. It was the tool that they found most effective in their hands to use. Now, can I say this? The way members of the body of Christ have treated these people has been horrendous. You can tell people that what the Bible says is sin without treating them bad. You do it out of love. And these people have been denied some basic rights in America that should have never been. I don't care who you are. Come on now. So we're part of the problem because of a religious spirit in the church that has fed the fire, and the elite said, I can work with that. And so what we have done is we have handed them the very mechanism to sever this nation away from this. I thought I would just throw that in. But this whole thing is a war against biblical Christianity, specifically Protestant Christianity. I did an interview here this last week with Johnny Circusi, and what came to me, because we always look at, well, having the middle class is something that is directly linked to the Constitution. Well, yes and no. We have other nations of the earth that have a middle class that don't have the Constitution. What they had was Protestant Christianity. The early Protestants respected the Torah of God. In fact, one of the neatest quotes I ran across talking about Wesley is, Wesley, his major job that he did, he preached the holiness of God, he preached the commandments of God, and God's holiness and the definitions of God's commandments became so real that sinners felt the depth of their sin. Boy, we need that again. And now we have most Christians get mad whenever you bring up the commandments. Welcome to the Cain spirit. Because it was God's commandment, it has to be a blood sacrifice. I like Dake's insights to this. He said, Cain brought forth the wrong sacrifice in self, will, and unbelief, and there was no acknowledgement of guilt or faith in the atonement. So by what Cain did, he says, I reject the concept of sin. I don't need atonement. And therefore, I'm just going to give you a tithe. Now bless me. Boy, he just smacked somebody right upside the head. And I can see in the spirit there's about 12 million of them. It's the truth. Don't offer to God that which has not been bought by blood. I told you we were going to have fun with this. When Cain and his offering was not respected by God, Cain did not repent. He got mad. Can anybody see that happening any place in America? Even the little babies. Yeah. Mom, Dad's watching TV. That's exactly what Grandpa's talking about right there. I'll tell you what right now. You see, because this has been going on, this has been brewing in America, this Cain and Abel story. I'm reading through three books right now by Doug Woodward. Actually, four. Him and I are kind of striking up a friendship now. And I got a, you know, I gave him one book to kind of catch up with me. I've got like nine to catch up with him. And he keeps sending me these articles and stuff. And I'm thinking, Doug, you're about to, it's all good stuff. It's like, I don't need to sleep anymore. I just need to read. It's such good stuff. But in his Power Quest 1 and 2, and then he kind of condensed it all together in Uncommon Sense, which I'm going to be, him and I are going to be doing a podcast about it here in a few weeks. In the 1800s, something happened in America. The Cain spirit rose up. And spiritualism began to explode in America. It took the spiritualism of the Middle East and of India and of Russia and of what was happening in Europe, came here and it exploded. That was intellectualism, the knowledge. All the intellectuals were into it. And Helena Blavatsky, Madame Blavatsky herself, had to move from Russia to America at the epicenter in New York to begin doing her work. And at the same time, in fact, I believe the spiritualism that developed and exploded and went through government and everything else in the 1800s is what built the platform for progressivism to be given birth to in the 1900s. So at the same time, the gospel of the Abels was being preached around the world so that America was the chief exporter of the gospel in the world. America was also the chief exporter of the doctrine of Cain around the world. In fact, Blavatsky is so revered among the occultist, we listen to, there's a guy named Keith Vieth, V-I-E-T-H, Blavatsky, I always get her, I don't like her, so I mispronounce her name on purpose. Maybe it's just a mental thing. Blavatsky. But his father-in-law in South Africa was in the bloodline of one of the direct three founders of the Illuminati under Weishaupt. And so before he got saved, he showed him a lot of the rituals, a lot of things they were doing. Now, you know, now he's saved, his wife saved, and they're Sabbath keepers, which separated them from everything occult to a great degree. And now his father-in-law is aged. I think he lost both of his legs probably from some type of disease, and so now he's needing help taking all these esoteric works that are never allowed to the public back to their center in South Africa. And so when he comes in, the channeler for that nation says, oh, you're related to him, and starts spilling a lot of secrets. Well, later on he goes, and he really wants the unedited works of Helena, I'll just call her that, Blavatsky, tomato, tomato, you know, and don't feel bad, I have people mess up the name Lake. He wanted her unedited works because when you go into Barnes & Noble, whatever, and you purchase Isaac Unveiled or the Secret Doctrine, those are edited versions. Only the elite are allowed the full versions of these documents that she channeled, like the United Nations, like the U.S. government, the Vatican, different places. And so he wanted a copy, so he goes back to this Chandler and says, I want her unedited works. And he says, you can't have them, they're priceless. I have the only copy in this nation in English. He says, but I really want them. He says, well, there's all these other books. No, that's kindergarten stuff. You want graduate school, right? You want her. And he ended up getting a copy in German from this guy. But what I thought was very interesting, he says, when I die, that my copy, and he didn't name the seminary, but it was a leading seminary that not only trains ministers, but professors for other seminaries, my copy will go there so that it can be used to train their ministers. Do you see why we're having the problem? The very essence of Cain, the unedited works of Cain, if you will, were being taken to a major seminary for the training of ministers and professors to be seeded out into other seminaries. All that originated because a Russian woman came to America in the birthplace of the spiritualism that was given birth in America. So we have had Cain and Abel functioning in America since its very foundation. Now, only Abels came over. We call them the Puritans, the Pilgrims. But then all the Cains saw the potential in America, and Kevin Bacon visioned this continent as the new Atlantis, this new occult utopia. So they all begin to come over. Francis Bacon. Who did I say? Kevin Bacon. Oh, Daddy helped me this morning. Yeah. Yeah, he was talking about the Footloose, New Atlantis. Maybe that's kind of... You say, why do you have mornings like this? Because it keeps me humble. And Lord knows, most of the time, I don't need any help. Blavatsky, there you go. Oh, dear me. I am edumacated. This some mornings it doesn't show. But we go on here in Genesis 4, 6 through 7. And the Lord said to Cain, why art thou wroth, and why has thy countenance fallen? If thou dost well, thou wilt not be accepted. And if thou dost not well, sin lieth at the door, and unto thee shall be his desire, and thou shalt rule over him. Now the first thing he does, he says, listen, guys, you know my instruction. It's right here. It's in a sense, it was in black and white for Cain. And he says, why are you rejecting my instruction? Why are you choosing another way? And he begins to plead with Cain. Then God makes this powerful statement. And I want to read it this time out of the Amplified to kind of untwist the Elizabethan English, if I may. If you do well, will you not be accepted? If you do well, won't fire fall? Why are you upset when I reject your disregard? Or I'm actually, bifocals are just working great this morning. You see, before I read this, what God is saying is, you know my instruction. You're upset when I reject your disregard for my instructions. You get mad at me that I have no respect for you disrespecting me. Is basically what Cain did. You want my respect, but you disrespect me, and you want me to respect your disrespect. I can't do it. And so then God makes this amazing statement. Let me get back here in the Amplified Bible. If you do well, will you not be accepted? If you do not well, sin crouches at your door. Its desire is for you, but you must master it. When I begin opening myself up to depart from the commandments of God and the instruction of God, sin crouches at the door. When I make another way except for that which God has provided, sin is crouching at the door because this iniquity desires to envelop you. But if you go back and repent and come back under the blood, you'll master it. Listen here, wayward Christian. You decided that you were going to do things your way instead of God's way, and you departed from the way of God. And God is telling you this morning that sin crouches at the door. If you'll repent and come back under the blood and go back to God's ways, you'll master that sin. If you don't, that sin will master you. And this year in 2015, God is giving an anointing to bring sin underfoot. Not only to bring sin underfoot, but to allow our giftings to flourish in God. That's why I'm seeing so many Christians around the world being activated to do things in this day and this hour. They say, I have wasted years under the Cain spirit, but now I'm going to be like my brother Abel. I'm going to repent, which is going to enable me. I kind of wonder if that doesn't have an etymological root in what Abel did. Maybe, maybe not. Maybe it's just a play of words. To really do what God's called me to do. In fact, the complete Jewish Bible translates it this way, which is backs up what the Amplified did. If you are doing what is good, should you not hold your head high? And if, because his countenance fell. And you can always tell when somebody's countenance falls because they go, you know, sometimes it's, you know, the anger like Cain. And if you do not do that which is good, sin is crouching at the door. It wants you, but you can rule over it. What a powerful statement. There are people today that are dying and they're shaking their fist at God as they begin entering into a burning hell. And God is saying, if you'd have done the right thing that was in my word, you could have mastered this thing. You could have brought iniquity under. But because you refused to bring iniquity under, you chose to be empowered by iniquity, it became master of you. You see, the truth of the matter is, guys, man was not created to be a god in himself. You got to serve somebody. Adam and Eve in the garden, when they were called to keep and to serve, that word to dress means to serve. The fact that word later on began to be used by those that were in Levitical and the Kohanim that served God in the temple and by teaching the word. They served God in the earth. Adam was created to serve God in the earth. And you got to serve somebody. Either you will serve the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, or you will serve iniquity and the one from whom that iniquity flows, and his name is Lucifer, and there's no other points. But what Lucifer does is says, no, I'm making you a god, while the whole time he makes you a slave. God comes on the scene and is truthful with you. I'm God, you're my servant. I want you to be a free servant, but you're still my servant in the earth. And because you're my servant, you can have dominion. What an outstanding concept. Sin will always seek to rule over us. It caused Cain to reject the instruction of God and to develop another way of acceptance or salvation. Sin was setting Cain up because it wanted to rule over him. Anytime you let a sin begin to blossom in your life, the reason it is there, it tells you, I'm here to give you pleasure, but what it's here to do is to make you a slave. There is no exception. Now, what happens? In verse 8, we find that Cain talked with Abel, his brother. Now, how many know that was going to really work out good? You see, right now there's a dialogue going on in America. There's a dialogue going on in the church. Cain says, Abel, I want to have a dialogue with you. Now, notice he didn't have a dialogue with God. He already had that. And it's very obviously what he decided. He goes to the faithful brother that chose to do things God's way and to come up under the blood. And it says, and it goes on to say, and it came to pass that when they were in the field that Cain raised up against Abel, his brother, and slew him. That is what is going to happen in America if God doesn't start judging some things. When Tom Horn brought a group of us guys together and to write some articles last year, that was a book called The Christian versus Christian War, he knew in his spirit that that was going to happen because he understood the dynamics of Cain and Abel. Those that reject the ways of God and refuse to come up underneath the blood, they will not repent, they get angry, and the only option they have is to get rid of those who were obedient to God. So we're going to start seeing, in fact, I'm already hearing it, you can listen from the hyper grace movement and the emergent movement, they are mocking those that believe this. In fact, this in the last couple of weeks, there was this minister that came out and said, I'm an atheist, but it shouldn't affect my place in the body of Christ or my position as pastor. Okay. Brother Cain, as long as your church is built upon Cainism, I agree with you. But you're going to hate and want to silence the Abelites in the world. Did you notice? Now, in America, we can have, let's say we have a Christian tell somebody, I can't bake your cake. But here's the address of a wonderful bakery that will do it even cheaper than I could do it. They're saying that's hate speech. One couple got on and said, they mentally raped us by refusing to bake our cake. But at the same time, now they never go into a Muslim bakery. We had a conservative guy go into many Muslim bakeries. Now some of them would bake up, and some of them says, you go down to Kroger. Do you notice there's no lawsuits? But yet in Muslim countries, not only will they not bake your cake, they'll kill you. Now that's okay. But the Christian not baking the cake is horrendous. And nobody's saying, listen, it's a difference of opinion. And guys, I have a right if it pricks my conscience, no matter what it is. You know, if I was a baker and the KKK would come in wanting to say, kill all blacks, I wouldn't bake that cake either. In fact, there have been many Christians go into gay bakeries and say, I believe in traditional marriage. And they won't bake their cake, but there's no lawsuit. Why? Because it's really a war on Christianity. It's not a war on Islam that they will kill you for being that. Because it's a war on the righteous. Let's go on here. And Cain talked with his brother Abel, and it came to pass that when they were in the field, and Cain rose up against Abel, his brother, and slew him. And the Lord said unto Cain, where is Abel thy brother? And he said, I know not, am I my brother's keeper? And he said, what hast thou done? The voice of thy brother's blood crieth unto me from the ground. Boy, there's a sermon right there. The power of blood is because blood has a voice. The Bible says life is in the blood. And if the blood of Abel cries around the nations of the world where we have turned a woman's womb into the altar of Molech, and we are killing the most ultimate innocent, and in the occult, the more innocent the sacrifice, the greater the power. That's why they believe in child sacrifice. What type of crying is going out today? There's a prophet of God named Henry Groover, and if you've ever listened to Henry Groover, you just can't help but love him if you're a believer. And he would go and he would prayer walk through these cities. And one of the things that he began to do, he began to hear babies crying. And it was coming from the sewer system. And he would follow it all the way up to an abortion clinic. Now, he has been called a liar about this, and so he has had liberals in different countries blindfold him, take him into the center of the city, and just release him. And so he's in a strange city. He does not know where he is, and he will begin praying and begin listening, and he will begin hearing the cries, and he will walk straight to the abortion clinic in that area of the city. This stuff's real. And you want to know why judgment's coming? because blood is crying out. Blood is crying out in the Middle East of all the Christians. It's reached heaven. Things are going to begin to happen. Now, the good news is the Bible says that there is another blood that speaks. Hebrews chapter 12, verses 24 through 25. And Jesus, the mediator of the new covenant, and to the blood of sprinkling that speaketh better things than an of Abel. Abel cried out, his blood was crying out for vengeance. The blood of Jesus, which is represented by the blood of the sacrifice that Abel presented, speaks something else. It says covered, redeemed, forgiven. You see, in this day, in this hour, what separates the Cains from the Abels is what are you covered by? You have to have a covering, because we find out in the garden that without a covering, you are butt naked to the world. Come on. Everything of who you are and what you got is exposed to everybody around you. And if we could see from a fourth dimensional reality, no matter what, you could have an Armani suit on, you could have a $10,000 suit on, the best suit made to mankind, but when you look from a fourth dimensional reality, you are still naked and undone, and your mail can be read by the spirit world, unless it's covered in the blood. If it's covered in the blood, then we go to an Ephesians chapter 6 reality that blood becomes armor. To God, he sees the blood and he sees redeemed. It allows him to look away from your sin and to see who you are in Christ. But to the devil, that blood becomes armor. No wonder the devil hates that blood so much. Right now, there's so many in the body of Christ that call themselves believers. And guys, they're not even running around in the world in their BVDs. They don't have any. The emperor has no clothes. And they're running around saying, we represent God in the earth. And from that second heaven reality, they're Cain from beginning to end. Literally. But at the same time, there are those in the earth that are waking up. The remnant is waking up. And they have been redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. They said, God, we're the ones that messed up, not you. That we are going to follow your instruction. And the number one command for those that don't believe in the commandments of God, the number one New Testament command, which opens up all the others, it's not a suggestion. You believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. You believe what he did for you. You believe in that shed blood. You believe in his spotless life, that he lived God's commandments perfectly. And he was the Lamb of God that came to be that perfect sacrifice. If you do that, you'll be saved. If you don't, you're going to hell. That is the gospel, and it is a command. It's not a suggestion. If you believe that commandment, then it opens up all the rest of the commandments of God for you. If you reject that, you'll hate every commandment in the book. In fact, in today's church, the only commandment that the Cainites love is thou shalt tithe, because they bring the fruits and vegetables of their labor and say, now bless me. God can't bless what the blood doesn't cover. It's another spirit and another kingdom blessing it. And what we've got is the big eye. Today in the church, it's not who's blessing it, but how blessed it is that sets the precedent. I would rather have this much blessing and be under the blood than to have more than this building could hold and to do it by the Cain spirit. because sin has dominion and it's blessing it. It's like every supernatural manifestation is not of God. There are a lot of things going on right now in charismatic ministries that are not God. They are not of the, there's prophetic utterances being released that are being released by the Cain spirit, and they're not of God. You better go back to see if it's under the blood and if it's walking in the ways of God or not. Isn't that how you tell a prophet? It doesn't matter if everything he says comes to pass, but if he takes you away from the ways of God, he's a false prophet, because it's a Cain spirit prophesying. Guys, it's time for us to wake up. It's time for us to grow up and be bold and say, I am of Abel. I am faithful to the instructions of my Creator. And I will accept his sacrifice and his sacrifice only. I will accept his instruction and no other. Because I am found in him, I will walk like him in the earth to bring him glory and to find my place in the kingdom of God. Now, Father, I just ask that for every one of us. Father, let us come under the blood today. Let us receive your sacrifice today. And let us walk in your instruction as the Holy Spirit writes your Torah upon our hearts. Let us live it from our heart and not from our head, so that a religious spirit has no place to get in. And Father, we thank you and we praise you for it today. In Jesus' name.